We're here with Bechara Choucair. Did I get it right?
You did.
Oh, Chief Community Health Officer at Kaiser Permanente. Did I get your position right also?
You did.
Great. We're so excited that you're here to do one of our community ground rounds. And we want to take advantage of everything that you know about social determinants of health, and community and health, so that we can share this with as many people as possible. And some people may not be able to make it to the event tonight. So welcome officially to Spectrum Health Lakeland.
Well, thank you, Norma, for inviting me. I am super excited being here, and community events have always been having special place in my heart, and to be invited to speak at a community grand rounds is near and dear to my personal interests.
Wonderful. So why don't we start at a very basic level and tell us, what's a chief community health officer?
Well, if you think about health, it's very easy for us to think about health as physical health or mental health. The reality, though, is what impacts health and what advances health. Yes, it is the physical health. Yes, it is the mental health, but it's also the communities where people live. And that's where we truly believe that health is about body, is about mind, and is about community. And if we want people to optimize their health, we have to be thinking about all these three areas. And that's why the same way you have a chief medical officer, you have someone who's focusing on the mind with mental health services, an organization like Kaiser Permanente and other health organizations really need to be able to focus on the community as an integral part of advancing health.
Great. So let's get right into those issues of community. I know that since you've been there, Kaiser Permanente has done some work with housing and patients. How is housing an issue for somebody's health?
Well, I'm a family physician, and I trained in a healthcare for the homeless program during my family medicine residency training. I got a chance to spend time in healthcare for the homeless programs in Rockford, Illinois, and Chicago. And to me, and to a lot of people, a lot of researchers, a lot of evidence that housing and health are so interconnected. Mm-hmm. If you think about it, what we know is that people who are homeless live 27 years on average less than those who are housed. Mm-hmm. We also know that people who are homeless are at an increased risk of having communicable diseases, multiple chronic conditions, and even as a health system, what we know is that when you're homeless and you're admitted to the hospital, on average you're staying 2 to 3 days longer. And when you're discharged from the hospital, your chances of being readmitted are 50% higher. So housing and health are so interconnected. And for us as an organization to be a health organization, we have to be in the housing business, and we have to be partnering in our communities in a way that would allow us to making sure that housing issues are addressed from all kind of different levels.
So tell me more about the partnerships that you believe are needed in a community to bridge the healthcare disparities gap.
Yeah, absolutely. So maybe we'll start actually with housing. We'll take that as an example. And our approach to housing, I mean, we're a health organization. We probably might not be the best suited community organization to take on housing by ourselves. We have to be able to engage others in the communities. We have to be able to engage governments at all different levels, local, state, and federal level. We have to engage other not-for-profit organizations in our communities who are working day in and day out with people who are homeless. We have to be able to engage other private organizations, maybe for-profit entities as well, whose housing are impacting, you know, the housing issues are impacting their employees and their vitality. And that's why it's really all about bringing everybody together. And we could bring to the table what we do best and try to leverage that with others in co-designing solutions to address issues like housing.
So another area that's really in the headlines for us in this community right now is education. We have a poor Black community in our area that is at risk of losing its high school, and it's made national news. So can you talk about the importance of having a thriving educational system and the impact of that that has on health?
I can't emphasize more how important education is to the health and vibrancy of a community. This is so critical. I've seen it every day during my tenure as health commissioner in Chicago for 5 years, and I see it every day as the chief community health officer for Kaiser Permanente. And for us as an organization, we are taking that very, very seriously, and that's why we're investing in a program we call Thriving Schools, where we're in over 750 schools in our communities working on things like healthy eating, active living, building resiliency in our schools for our students, for our teachers. So many of our students have been exposed to adverse childhood events, and we know the impact of those on the lives of those students and their future. That's why we're investing lots of resources. We're investing time and energy in working with over 500,000 students in our communities, with thousands, tens of thousands of teachers and administrators in our communities, to strengthen that link between education and health, because at the end of the day, this is a key determinant of health.
Wonderful. So our vision at Spectrum Health is to have personalized care that is simple, affordable, and exceptional. If we're going to meet that vision, how does community health come into play?
You know, Norma, one thing we've done earlier this year is we've surveyed people in this country to try to see where social health fits in their day-to-day lives. And what we've learned, and we've taken a representative sample of people in this country, what we've learned is that 68% of people in this country have had at least one social needs in this last year. 68%. And those social needs are things like affordable housing, food security, transportation access, economic vitality, or social isolation. What we also learned is 25% of people, actually 28% of people, have had a social need that was a barrier to their health, which means that they have to make a choice between either paying for their rent or purchasing their medication. Do they buy food, or do they come and see their doctors? So as you're thinking about your personalized approach to your patients, and that's how we're thinking about it at Kaiser Permanente, now we're asking about the social health of our members the same way we ask them about their physical and their mental health. And we're building the infrastructure so that we can meet the social needs of our members the same way we meet their physical needs and their health, mental health needs. And that's a key shift for us as an organization. And that's why we've committed to building 39 networks of social services agencies in each one of our service areas across the country that will be a provider network for our members to meet the social needs of our members. So I would encourage you to think about that personalized approach that also include thinking about addressing head on the social needs of your members and your patients.
Great. So before you worked at Kaiser and before that Trinity, you worked in public policy. So talk to us about the connection between public policy and being able to, again, deal with healthcare disparities.
Absolutely. So I'm a family physician. I trained as a family physician. I was seeing patients as a practicing physician in Chicago. And I've realized very early on that if I only focus on my patients one-on-one, which as important as that was and is and will continue to be, there is a big role that government can play mm-hmm. from a policy change perspective, so you can change the environment more upstream so that you don't have to be dealing with issues downstream that my patients were dealing with. And to me, that was an important pivot in my career when I've realized that I can continue to see patients day in and day out, but maybe I can have a better impact if I can start thinking about changing the policies that are creating the systems that are making my patient to be homeless, that are making my patient food insecure, that are making my patient socially isolated. And the connection there is so critical, and we're seeing that day in and day out. And part of our work at Kaiser Permanente is identifying sets of policies that we would like to see every one of our cities adopt, our states adopt. On the housing front, we've partnered with the U.S. mayors and CEOs for U.S. Housing Investments, which is a coalition of 20-plus mayors and CEOs from across the country that identified a set of bipartisan policies that we know would make a difference when it comes to housing in this country. So the policy work is an integral part of how we think about community health work.
Yeah. Great. I have one last question for you.
Sure.
Bechara. And that is a little bit more personal. So you started your career providing healthcare for homeless. How did that affect who you have become as a physician, as a healthcare provider?
Yeah. Well, thank you for asking this question. And just actually earlier today, I was thinking about one of my patients when I was a practicing physician in the Healthcare for the Homeless program in Rockford, Illinois at Crusader Community Health. Her name is Judy, and she was in her mid-30s. She was this wonderful woman, vibrant personality, always smiling, full of energy. And I got to be her doctor for a few years as I was practicing there. And, you know, we talked and worked on aches and pains here and there. She struggled with substance use. She had a bipolar disorder for which she was getting treated. And we've had so many conversations over the years. And I remember this one day when we were talking and she was telling me about how it's so important what we all talk about every day when she comes to the clinic, but what she's really worried about is if she's going to be able to survive the next winter in Rockford, in the Midwest. She sleeps in the parks. And I always remember those conversations that we've had, and you can tell the day I've realized that there was somebody who died from hypothermia in a park and turned out to be Judy, that that had a huge impact on the way I thought I failed her and how our society has failed her, our systems that we've put in place have failed her. And here you have the richest country in the world treating and creating the systems that allow people to sleep in the parks even when it's 20 below and have people die in the parks because we don't have systems in place to make sure that people have shelter, which is just a basic human right. And to me, I always remember many of my patients, because Judy would always be front and center to my mind about the importance of the work that we do that help us change the structures, the systems, the policies that we've put in place that really lead to these types of outcomes. And to me, that would always be front and center.
Oh, thank you. Well, thank you for sharing your story. Thanks for all the work that you're doing to help us eliminate healthcare disparities. And thanks for coming to Spectrum Health Lakeland and sharing your knowledge with us.
Thank you for hosting me. I look forward to later tonight.